Nilan Abrahamson is going to be giving the talk today. He's been he's a grad student at MIT. He's working with John Kellner and Peter Shore. He's had like a host of recent results on local Hamiltonians and AGSBs and things like that. And so he's going to be talking about those things today. So I'm pretty excited about hearing them. And in terms of logistics, if everyone can mute their mics while he's talking, but if you want to ask a question, you can either just unmute yourself and ask the question, or you can write it in the chat and I will hopefully see it and then relay that to Nilan. So yeah, without further ado, Nilan, take it away.
Okay, thank you very much. Thanks for this opportunity to speak here, and thanks to Caitlin for helping with the tech. So I'm going to talk about local Hamiltonians and some properties of the spectrum. So let's start by introducing the setting. So this is we're interested in a complex a quantum system that is consists of many small quantum systems, and there's n of these small quantum systems at the sites which we think of as, we can think of them as vertices in a graph. And then the state of this entire system lives in the tensor product of the local Hilbert spaces, each of which has a constant dimension. Sometimes you think about these sites as particles, but you can also think of them as modes that for fermions, for example, where that might have that have some occupation number. So the occupation number is that local degree of freedom. So that's of course relevant for chemistry. So that's the space of the possible states, and then we want to have an energy operator on it, and this operator will be of a specific form. It's a sum of local terms, and we index these by E because I think of these as living on hyper edges on the hypergraph, and it'll be K local. So that means that these hyper edges, each of them is incident to at most k vertices, where k is some constant. Okay, so you have bounded interaction strengths. That's local operator norms. And so this is the operator that's called the local Hamiltonian, and it gives a concise description. So that gives you the description of the system in polynomial space, where the complexity parameter is the number of sites. But since the Hilbert space itself is this tensor product that has exponential size, you can't do your usual linear algebra diagonalization methods to find the energies. And so there's two perspectives that you might come to this from. Any convex combination of them, but these questions come from physics, of course, and from quantum physics. And if you think about condensed matter physics, then you'll often think about a very specific model where the interactions are on the lattice. They might be translational invariant, and then you'll probably want to exactly solve your model. The physicist will try to compute properties by hand. Example of an exactly solvable model is this AKLT spin chain, which has an entangled ground state that you can describe explicitly. And then there's this other viewpoint that you can have, which is, the local Hamiltonians are a quantum generalization of constraint satisfaction problems. So the classical version, you would have you can choose a label for each vertex, and then these labels need to satisfy local constraints. But here, local doesn't mean that you have any geometric locality. It's just the number of vertices that each constraint looks at. So you have these very arbitrary geometries. And then your notion of solving the question will also be much weaker, that you wish to not specifically not compute the energy by hand, but you divide it into complexity classes. So an example of that is the Cook-Levin theorem in classical computer science. It says that 3-sat is NP hard. And that also has this quantum version. So we're interested in finding the lowest eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian, we're interested in the eigenvalues in general and the lowest one in particular. Kitaev in a talk remarked that it's QMA hard, or he observed that it's QMA hard to compute the ground state energy for a local Hamiltonian. And this is done using this quantum clock construction. So then you might ask, you know, can this notion of approximation be weakened and it's still QMA hard? And that's an open conjecture. The quantum PCP conjecture says that it's still QMA hard if you just want to approximate the ground state energy. And this approximation error that you allow is basically the worst that you could, the weakest notion of approximation that you can get away with, because M here is the number of hyper edges. So the triangle inequality trivially bounds your energy between in an interval of length 2m. Now you're asking if you can approximate up to an error that's a small constant times that. The small constant is called epsilon. So, you know, this seems like a strong conjecture, but the analogous classical result is true, that it's NP hard to approximate the value of a constraint satisfaction problem up to this error. So, you know, this motivates, this serves as one of the motivations for approximation methods for local Hamiltonians. So these first three papers here, say that you have good approximations under various conditions of the energy, of the ground state energy, just by looking at product states. And if you have a good enough such approximation, then that'll give you that'll place a problem in NP, right, which would disprove the conjecture. Either disprove it if QMA is different from NP, or make it vacuous if they're the same, which we don't expect. So this recent paper by Anurag and David and Karen Moyens also gives a good approximation, then it goes beyond product states. And then there's also a result in this, in kind of the opposite direction, saying that for some ground states, you can't approximate them. You know, you cannot approximate them with low-dips circuits. So the question of approximating the energies up to this large error leads to a lot of interesting research problems. And so it motivates me to look at a related question. You know, what does a spectrum look like? Right. So let's say I want to draw the histogram of this spectrum. So this is this empirical spectral distribution. And the number of bars should be a large constant. That's the notion of approximation that we're looking at. Then the quantum PCP problem is just, what is the leftmost bar? Right. If we can solve that, then you could solve that problem. But you can't. I can't solve that. So let me think of an easier problem. which is just approximate some of the quantiles. You know, loosely speaking, I just want to approximate this distribution and allow an epsilon m error in the horizontal direction. Okay, so you can actually do this by computing the moments. Why? Because we can compute the moments, we can compute a constant number of moments in polynomial time just by seeing that the pth moment is the trace of the Hamiltonian raised to the pth power, and then expand each of these p factors. That gives you m to the p terms here, and each of them acts on only a few qudits. Exponential in p, but that's still constant.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So, Nelin, about this picture, what does the height of the histogram represent here in the interval epsilon m?
It is the number of eigenvalues in that interval.
Oh, but not the number of eigenstates.
That's that's right. So so I will briefly mention that there's a more general problem that you've worked on. But it's just the number of eigenvalues. Yeah.
Okay, including degeneracy. I mean, you include degeneracy.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. So this is.
Sorry, Nilan, I actually didn't understand the resolution of that comment. Are you including multiplicity or no in the bar height?
Multiplicity is included. Yeah.
Got it. Thanks.
if you want to approximate a distribution, an obvious measure to evaluate your error is this Earth mover distance. And there's a paper that says that if you want to get to the relevant error in Earth mover distance, that would be error epsilon m here, then you would just need order 1 over epsilon moments, meaning you need the number of moments you would need would be the order of the number of intervals that we've divided this into. Because we're in this QPCP kind of regime, that would be constant. Right, so this seems like a reasonable algorithm, but unfortunately, it doesn't tell us much because it turns out that, you know, that it'll just give you a single bar in the middle. And you can see that to a first approximation by computing the variance by hand. So this will give that the variance, it has this m squared, which is because of the length of the big interval, and then divided by n. So that tells you that the 99th percentile will end up just being in the middle bar, and the first percentile, and even the alpha quantiles where alpha is one over of order 1/n. But finding a single eigenvalue, finding the lowest energy, corresponds to a inverse exponentially small fraction of the quantiles. So I want to get closer to that. So, and it turns out that that's still true, that the only quantiles that are hard to approximate will be an exponentially decreasing fraction of them. So saying this in a slightly more in a more direct way is just that we are proving a concentration bound for the spectrum. Oh yeah, so so this example here, I want to think of not necessarily something that looks like a nice interaction hypergraph, right? So it's K uniform, meaning that the interactions involve only k, a bounded number of vertices, but each vertex can be in a large number of interactions. So that's this G regularity. Each vertex is in G interactions, and this can be large, unbounded. So an example is a complete graph. I want to include that in as possible examples. That's two uniform, and it has degree n, n minus one. Okay, so the statement of the theorem is here. The K uniform and Z irregular, and you get this exponential concentration bound, where you note that there's no G in here. So even if it has very large degree, that does not decrease the quality of your bound.
Sorry, Nilan, what is the C on the interval? Yeah, like the C that's there, yeah.
Oh, complement.
Oh.
Yeah, I just wanted to say it in words, but this is the middle, the small middle interval. And so I'm mm-hmm. saying the measure of the complement of that is small.
Got it.
Yeah. Okay, I want this to hold even for large degree, and I get the inverse exponential concentration. So yeah, so that's the proposition. Let's give the proof.
Sorry, one more question, Nilan. Like this thing is the measure, so it's a it's like divided by 2 to the n, right? Like
That's right. Yeah.
Thank you.
So let's give the proof of this. I should have put that in there. So let's get the proof. It's quite short. So some related results are proven also by dividing the Hamiltonian into sets where each set is a matching, meaning that you divide it into sets of edges where within each set they don't overlap. Right? You can also think of that as a coloring of the edges. And I also do that, but I just combine them in a different way. I combine them using Weyl's inequality. Okay, so let me just introduce the notation. The cumulative distribution function at lambda, it takes lambda and then it outputs the number of eigenvalues below lambda. Okay, so now what does Weyl's inequality say? Says that if you have a decomposition, you have a sum of two Hamiltonians, then you can lower bound the eigenvalues of the sum in terms of the eigenvalues of the two Hamiltonians separately. So now note that these indices I and j, so these are, you know, the lambda I is the ith smallest eigenvalue, starting at zero. So note that these are actually the same as f, right? F is number of eigenvalues below lambda. So that's just counting how many there are. So you can also rewrite this Weyl's inequality using the CDF, and that looks like this. So now let's do the decomposition. You can think of that as a coloring using some number g of colors. And then you have a CDF for the spectrum of each within each color. So what we want is we wanted to prove a tail bound. So let's prove a bound on the left tail, what's left of the middle bar. That's the same as bounding the CDF at the left endpoint of the middle bar. So that's what we have here, bounding the CDF at that left endpoint. Now use Weyl's inequality. And then Yeah, so using Weyl's inequality, now we get the CDF for the individual colors. So let's say, so here you have MI in here, which is the number of red upper edges, say. And then you can use the classical concentration bounds, Chernoff bounds, Hoeffding's inequality, to get, you know, to get exponential concentration where the parameter is the number of red edges. You know, unfortunately, if you have a large degree, then you'll get a large number of colors, which means that the number of edges with each color becomes smaller. But on the other hand, if you have large degree, then the number of edges you had to start with is large compared to the number of vertices. So those two effects cancel out. So this number of red edges, you can relate that to the number of vertices. So then we get this concentration bound.
Wait, Nilan, can you go back? Where did this coloring come in? So these HI terms, is that the sum of all of the particular terms of the same color?
That's right. Yeah.
And what's K?
Oh, K is the locality, which is okay. Constant. Yeah.
So if you were to run this argument for a complete graph, then you would need n colors, right?
That's right. Yeah. And m would be n squared, right?
Yeah.
So then we end up with
right.
With n.
I see. So yeah, you're still arguing that for a complete graph, each HI would be a combination of n different independent terms, and that's fine.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks.
Okay, so that's the proof of this concentration bound. So now let me mention related results. So there's this more general question where you think of H as an observable, and then you want to see the you want to find the distribution of that in some state row. It's more general because the spectral question that I was looking at is just the same for the is this question for the maximum mixed row. So this is a more general question, and there's been work on concentration bounds for this. So it's also by Anurag and Kuhara that, you know, also do these decompositions and combine them using moments. And they're more, so these are more focused on, you know, more focused on lattices and short range correlations. So the bounds do not carry over to, for example, the complete graph. But again, it's a more general question. Okay, for the same question, Kuhara and Saito actually give a bound that holds for long range correlation. So it's a similar flavor of bound as we have here. Much more difficult result. And you know, the quantitative bound is somewhat weaker. So an interesting open question, I think, is if you could get the less general, stronger bound from here, right? For the spectrum, if you get a similar bound for the more general question that they look at. Okay, and then there's a paper that came on the archive the same day as mine that defines a quantum Earth mover distance and uses that to give concentration bounds for local Hamiltonians. So some open questions related to this, the bottom one I just mentioned. And then these bounds also suggest that you have a central limit theorem. That is that the spectrum not only concentrates, but it looks like a Gaussian. This is known in 1D, but I don't think it's known beyond that. And I think it holds in much greater generality. Okay, so now let me switch gears a bit and go to the more structured settings. So more structured meaning that we're looking at lattices and specifically 1D and 2D and consider Hamiltonians that have a spectral gap. So there it was shown in, it's been shown in 1D that such ground states of gapped Hamiltonians have a constant entanglement bound if you split the spin chain into two halves. And this, when this was proved by Hastings, it was already known that it would give a efficient classical representation as matrix product states. And later it was used to prove polynomial time algorithms to compute the ground state. And then these results, these structural results, you can generalize and think about generalizing them in different ways to higher dimensions. So one generalization is the area law, and a different, stronger generalization would be, can you approximate the ground state by a tensor network, which on lattices specifically is called the PEPS. So these two are both open, but the area law entanglement bound, so there you can give a different, Anurag and David and Isaiah Arad gave a different entanglement bound, which is bounded by the this power of the circumference of a region. And because this power is less than two, this gives a subvolume law. Then I'll get back to later the question which Anurag mentioned to me, this relation to does this also give you something about PEPs with smaller bond dimensions? Okay. So the subvolume law, I quote it here. The assumption is this uniform gap assumption. And supposing that you have this uniform gap and are frustration free, you get this subvolume entanglement bound. And the proof goes by constructing a appropriate AGSP, approximate ground state projector. And so the rest of what I'm going to talk about is mostly, you know, analyzing these approximate ground state projectors. Constructing them, as for constructing them, the work has already been done. So I'm going to focus on this analysis of its application. So using this AGSP construction, I give a sub-exponential time algorithm to compute the ground states in 2D under the same assumptions. And the algorithm uses it has this one-dimensional structure, and its output is a matrix product state, which is also one-dimensional object, where I consider a column of qudits, you know, as one large virtual qudit. Now, in making an algorithm which has this one-dimensional flavor, there is one piece of technology from the 1D algorithms that's very important. Because if you look at the first algorithms and most of the algorithms for 1D, their running time is exponential in the entanglement rank, which is again exponential in the entanglement entropy. So you get a running time that's doubly exponential in the entanglement entropy. And you know, here, the entanglement being a power of n, that would give an awful running time. So and the crucial way to get out of this is to reduce complexity by doing this random sampling procedure. This is by Rad Landau, Vaswani Vidic. Okay. So these algorithms and entanglement bounds, they all use these approximate ground state projectors. So let me define those. So an approximate ground state projector, to define it, we think of a local Hamiltonian. We're given a local Hamiltonian. It has some space of ground states, which we call Z. And now we forget about the Hamiltonian for a moment, and we just think of Z as our target space. And then the AGSP is an operator which keeps the ground states invariant or makes these vectors grow and shrinks the vectors that are orthogonal to it. So it's an operator that has this form, so it acts separately on the space of ground states and on the orthogonal complement. And on the ground states, it's a dilation, so the output vector is larger than the input vector. On the orthogonal complement, it shrinks them by a factor square root delta. Okay, and this decomposition is you can't construct these two summons separately. You can only construct them together. So given such an AGSP, from the beginning of when it was introduced, I believe this is a paper that introduced the terminology, you get this lemma which tells you that if you have an AGSP, then you get an entanglement bound, if you have a good one. Of course, you want a small shrinking factor, but in getting a small shrinking factor, you get a more complex operator, which is the complexity measured by the entanglement rank. And now you want the shrinking factor to win out. So you want that when you multiply the two, you still get something small. Under that assumption, if you have a unique ground state, then you get your entanglement bound. So in 1D, once the area laws and algorithms had been shown, there were several works that generalized to degenerate ground states, so meaning non-unique ground states, first constant and later polynomial degeneracy. But now it feels like if you're able to do this, to generalize it to degenerate case, then maybe there should also be a lemma like this that makes it easy. And in fact, you can, if you read the proofs in this work, then you can get a similar implication, but it has a, so the proof is limited in the way that you will require a slightly stronger assumption, which is that the shrinking factor should not only defeat R, but it should defeat R squared. And I just, I feel like this, we should find out if there's like some gap in some fundamental reason why these should be different. But it turns out that you can get the original, a straight generalization of the original lemma. So you don't need to be a unique ground state anymore. It can be degenerate, and if it satisfies the same assumption on the trade-off, then you get your entanglement bound. And
Nilan, but this bound is not so great, like if D is exponential in the number of qubits, for example, right?
So if D is so that's of course the largest it could be. I want this to hold for every state in the ground space, and if I want to state it in that way, then you're going to have this.
Oh, okay.
Now I have thought about whether you can, you know, stated differently. So it's not for every state in there, but there's maybe a, you know, you can somehow make it as a combination of things that satisfy a better bound. I think it's not so easy to formulate that even.
Thanks.
So one question, Nilin. Why do you think this log D is necessary? Is because there could be, like, you know, some examples where you have this large entropy?
Yeah, so because I want this to hold for every state in the ground space. Okay. You know, you could say, I mean, it would be very interesting to get rid of the log D and have a different notion, which is not every for everything in there. But right. But given that I want to, given that we try to formulate it in this setting, you know, if you had the zero Hamiltonian, you know, your ground space is the entire subspace, the entire, you know, right. The entire Hilbert space. You know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah, but if you have a basis, you can ask if there's a basis of states for which.
Yeah, that is true. And that is an. I mean, that's a very interesting question.
All right. Thanks.
I mean, I thought about this question at one point, and I remember it sort of led me, and I don't exactly remember what the connection I was making was, but it sort of led me to this paper by Ramis and Peter Shore and others that that tells you. Okay, that you know that gives that gives you a that talks about when are your ground states okay, when is a Hamiltonian frustration free, and then you know given some assumptions on the local interactions and it's on a spin chain, and the connection that I'm making there is that when they can prove that it's frustration free, they also get a large space of ground states, and those are given by matrix product states, so they have low entanglement, you know, even though it's large. So
right,
yeah, it would be good to have it would be good to have a more clear picture of this.
Right.
Yeah. okay. So what does an AGSP do, right? Well, what do our algorithms do? There is some unknown space Z of ground states, and then we approximate it with some other ground other subspace that we can construct efficiently. And ideally, this space would contain Z, but then there's some, you know, inaccuracies. So instead, we want it to overlap onto Z. So, you know, Z is the thing that we're looking for, this space. And then the W is the overlapping space that we can compute. And I've drawn it here just by drawing some spheres inside the subspace. And then there's two parameters. There's the overlap mu, and then there's the error, viability error, delta. So these you can think of as cosine squared and delta squared, where the angle is the largest principal angle between them. Of course, I want to think of Z as being larger than this. So then, you know, there's lots of different principal angles between them. Okay. So if you want to, if you have your W, which is the approximating space, you apply the AGSP, then you want the delta to become smaller and the mu to become larger. And now let's look at the how this is analyzed in the literature. You start with your W and apply your your HSP, which shrinking factor, big delta. And then you get the new thing will have an error that is big delta over mu squared. And this is sufficient to get many things, but it is kind of not ideal because for a couple of reasons. For one thing, if you start with something that is close to z, right? So it has a small error delta. You would like to keep that when you apply your HSP, but here there's no delta on the right-hand side, or there's no little delta on the right-hand side. So it doesn't preserve, if you have a small error, it doesn't preserve this. And if you have a small overlap, if you have a poor approximation, you know, then to get any non-trivial output, then your HSP needs to be very very strong. So it appears that if you have a moderately good HSP and you have a small, either a very good approximation or a very poor approximation, then you wouldn't even want to apply your HSP because the bound on the new subspace would be trivial. So I improved this bound, and the most precise way of stating it is look at this fraction, which, because delta and mu are like the sine and cosine, these fractions are like tangent squared. So you just multiply the tangent by the shrinking factor. You multiply the tangent by the squared shrinking factor. So in particular, compared to the previous bound, it's improved by something a little better than a factor delta mu, which is consistent with what I said before, that if you start with a really poor approximation, so mu is small, or a very good approximation, delta is small, then the old bound would not be very good, but the new bound is. So now I should argue, because I'm advertising this, I should argue that the proof is not non-trivial. So let's try to make a trivial proof of it. Well, geometrically, intuitively, it makes sense, I would say, just by looking at the angles. But let's try to do this trivial proof. So you have the new approximating space where you've applied the HSP, take a vector in there that comes from some vector in the original approximating space. And now you can make a decomposition with respect to your target space Z, where Z is, okay, where epsilon here is the orthogonal part. And this plays very well with the HSP, right? Recall that the HSP acts on Z and its orthogonal complement separately. So the HSP shrinks the orthogonal part. So that seems like we're done, because now we have a good decomposition of this vector. But the problem is, the approximating space here was, it could be. So this is overlapping onto Z, right? So the vector here that we wanted to decompose, this doesn't actually have this good decomposition. It doesn't have this good decomposition with respect to Z. What is true is that a vector in Z has a good decomposition with respect to W. So, but if we did that, then that decomposition wouldn't play with the HSP. Okay, so different ways you can solve this, but one of the ways is that you replace W with a subspace that is homeomorphic to Z, so you get the symmetry between the two. Okay, so we have this improved analysis of the HSPs, and it gives us this entanglement bound, which I call it the off-the-rack bound, because it's you just give it the HSP, and then it immediately gives you your entanglement bound. The other thing that the AGSP analysis here helps with it is it gives us somewhat simpler one-dimensional algorithms, 1D meaning spin chains, because now because it works in different overlap, different regimes of the overlap, you don't need to have these nested loops where you keep you keep iterating to improve it, improve the overlap a little bit, and then make the complexity a little smaller and improve the overlap again. Just do that all in one. So in this way, you can get algorithms for spin chains that just do a single, the only iteration is over the qubits. There's no nested loops. Okay, so then applying this with the AGSPs from the subvolume law of Anurag and David and Itai Awad, we get, okay, so from the off the rack bound, we get that this also holds for non-unique ground states, where it was previously stated for unique ground states. And the fun thing about 2D here is that, even if you had an area law, you would still have a huge entanglement, right? Even if you have an area law, the entanglement rank is exponential in square root n. So you can hide a large degeneracy in there. So the bound is unchanged if you have a sub-exponential degeneracy. And then there's the algorithm, which is basically the 1D algorithm that I sketched, that says that you can compute the ground state in time, again, in sub-exponential time. The output here is, as I indicated, is a matrix product state. So it's this, one-dimensional matrix product state with large bond dimension. You might complain that you don't want to get this kind of output because then you have to do a lot of, what are you going to do with it? It takes sub-exponential but a long time to get anything out of it. But the algorithm can prepare a lot of data just before, just include it with the output. So it could compute all the local expectation values and output a list of them. That would be, that would be a list of length 4n if we're talking about qubits. Or it could compute Pauli observables. And they don't have to be strictly local. It can also be a product of a Pauli that acts on each qubit. So that's just because you can contract this matrix product state before you output your result. Okay, so that's basically all the results. There's lots of open problems, of course. The 2D area law, related to the results I've talked about, can you make this algorithm more 2D like? And by doing so, maybe you could improve the space complexity, because this algorithm takes sub-exponential but large space. Note that a classical CS constraint satisfaction problem on a 2D lattice would also take probably 2 to the square root n time. And the algorithm would also be some sweep that looks like a one-dimensional algorithm. But at least the space complexity would be small. So maybe that can be achieved in the quantum case also. This is closely related to the question of the relation between an area law on one hand and a succinct PEPS tensor network representation on the other hand. this is a, you know, this is an interesting question. It's false for general states. That is, if you don't have the local Hamiltonian, if you don't require it to come from local Hamiltonian, but this argument doesn't carry over to the local Hamiltonian case. And then there's this related, basically a generalization of this implication. How does an entanglement bound, for example, a subvolume law, relate to a bond dimension of a PEPS to describe the state? I put this citation here because I wanted to attribute this conjecture to this paper. It was Anurag that mentioned this conjecture to me. I think such a result would be a big breakthrough, and it certainly doesn't seem easy. For one thing, it doesn't seem easy because if you just apply this implication to the trivial volume law entanglement bound, then that would give you a non-trivial bound on the bond dimension of a PEPS. So that's a very interesting question direction to look into. So that's all I have. And thank you all for listening.
Thanks, Nolan. Are there any questions for Nolan?
Well, I know you mentioned a lot of interesting directions, Nolan, but what are you working on now? I mean,
I'm working on my research statement.
Ah,
I'm looking for jobs.
Fair enough.
Yeah. And I'm attending this, I'm running like a reading group about Boolean functions, because there's some relations to quantum. And then I'm also attending this reading group that's John Wright and maybe others also, about quantum codes. So I'm learning a lot of things at the moment and not producing any results.
It was a nice talk, thanks.
Thank you very much, yeah, thanks.
So Nilin, one remark about the conjecture you mentioned is that I would expect it to be S over L whole square instead of S over L in the exponent.
Oh, did I not say what these things mean? Yeah, I guess I didn't. If you have an entanglement bound, this is basically what you explained to me. If you have an entanglement bound S, L is the I'm not sharing the screen, am I? Circumference of a region.
Right. Right.
Well, L is basically the length scale of the system.
L is the length scale of the system. Right.
Yeah. Right. So I think this is what you were explaining to me, right? Entanglement bound S, then you would imagine that if the entanglement spreads around the circumference of your region, then you could get to divide this by the length scale.
True. That's right.
In 2D, this should be the area in higher dimensions.
But if you go via polynomial degree, then you might get a little bit worse result, like S over L whole square. This is still possible. I'm not saying it's not possible. It's conjecture.
What's polynomial degree?
So, you know, if you were trying to prove the entanglement bound using a polynomial of certain degree.
Oh, yeah.
Then you expect the degree to be S square over L by the Arad-Landau Wasirani argument. So you'd expect the degree to amortize instead of entanglement to amortize. So if the degree amortizes, then you'd get S square over L square, which I would say would not imply what you wrote in the sub-item there. But it would still be consistent with the belief that area law implies constant bond dimension.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay, but am I wrong in attributing this to... You did mention this to me, right?
Yeah, so
or,
I think...
Or it's just too strong.
I think I mentioned this version, but I think I put a square there as well when I mentioned it. I don't know. But it doesn't matter.
I see.
But the spirit is correct, definitely. I mean...
I see.
Yeah. This would be the very good result if it's true, but I would expect in reality one would only be able to get S square over L square.
Okay.
This is still very non-trivial. If one can.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I really like your talk as well. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. But I guess, what you're saying, if you have squares on both of these, I do not get the problem that I said below.
Yes, you will not have this.
I see. Yeah.
It seems extremely strong, right? I mean.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That makes sense.
Right. All right. Thanks so much.
All right, are there any more questions? I guess we asked a lot of questions during the talk, so maybe not. All right, well, if not, let's thank Nolan again for a nice talk. And